ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us, the fitrah that He has placed inside of us, the way that Allah has structured mankind, our heart yearns for that which we love and that which we need. A sign of love and a sign of need is that your heart and soul, your body, your mind, is always contemplating over your object of love, over your object of need. It is not a coincidence that when you are hungry, you cannot but think of food. When you are thirsty, everything reminds you of water. When you are in love, you always think of your object that is beloved. This is the way that we have been created, and the two cannot be separated. Love and need must always be associated with thinking and pondering and yearning and desire. We know this and experience this in our daily lives for that which we love and yearn for our material needs. Now, the Muslim, the mu'min, who realizes that there is no object that is worthy of ultimate love other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mu'min who understands and appreciates that there is nothing that he is more in need of than the mercy of Allah. The mu'min who understands that he cannot even take a breath except that Allah blesses him with that breath. He cannot take a sip except that Allah has granted him that sip. When the mu'min understands the need, when the mu'min appreciates the love, when the mu'min understands he is a mu'min, then the natural consequence of this iman will be a constant thinking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A constant contemplation, a constant remembrance of Allah. And this remembrance in Arabic is called Zikr. This remembrance is called Zikr. And Zikr is the sign, it is the pulse of Iman. As we have said, as we have elaborated, when a person is in love, he will think of the object of His beloved. And the mu'min realizes that all loves of this world are temporary, transient, selfish. There is only one love that is ultimate. There is only one love that is really and truly above, transcending human existence, and that is the love of the divine. يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ Those who believe, they love Allah more than anything else. And the mu'min realizes that he is always in need of Allah. Therefore, the natural consequence of Iman is to be always thinking and remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this, as we said, is dhikr. Many of us ask, many of us wonder, how can I tell how strong my Iman is? What is the criteria that will demonstrate, that will illustrate how much Iman do I have? How do I measure my faith? Here, my dear brothers and sisters, is your answer. Dhikr is how you measure your faith. How often you think of Allah, how often you remember Allah, how often you glorify Allah, how much your mind is contemplating the wonders of the creation of Allah. This is a sign of your Iman.
The more you think of Allah, the more you remember Allah, the more that you have iman. And the less that you have dhikr of Allah, then really the fact of the matter, the less is your love of Allah. And the less is your realization that you need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The concept and blessings of dhikr are far more than can be enumerated in one simple khutbah. In fact, one of the greatest scholars of medieval Islam, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he wrote a very famous book, Al-Wabil al-Sayyib, The Drops of Dew. And in this book he compiled all of the blessings of dhikr that are mentioned in the Quran and Sunnah. And he found more than 100 specific and different blessings for doing dhikr. So how can we summarize all of these in one khutbah? What the goal is that insha'Allah ta'ala, we will entice ourselves, remind ourselves, we will motivate ourselves to increase in this dhikr. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to do his dhikr. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us of doing dhikr in dozens and dozens of verses in the Quran. Allah describes the believers as those who do dhikr. If you are a believer, you are of those who do dhikr. وَذَّاكِرِينَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَالذَّاكِرَاتِ. Those who do dhikr, men and women, frequently, أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةً وَأَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. These are the ones whom Allah has promised great reward and forgiveness. الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ. The believers are those who do dhikr of Allah, whether they're standing or sitting or lying down. It doesn't matter your state. When you're in love, you think of the object. When you're in need, you think of your desire. So the mu'min is always thinking and contemplating. يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ. Every single act of worship that Allah has legislated, every single religious ruling, it centers around the concept of dhikr. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِلذِّكْرِ. Establish the salah in order to show my dhikr. The very salah that we do, the very salah that we do, Allah says, I have only done this, I have only told you to pray. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِلذِّكْرِ. The Quran itself is called dhikr, because it reminds you, it is a reminding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, of the blessings of dhikr, of the blessings of dhikr, is that dhikr gives you life of the heart. Dhikr gives you life of the heart. You see, Allah created us with body and with soul. He created us with two separate and distinct elements, fused in one, merged in one. The body, which is the jasad, which is the flesh and bones, which is made from clay and dust and earth. But the body by itself is nothing. It is lifeless. It is a corpse. What did Allah do after He fashioned Adam with His own two hands? فَنَفَخْنَا فِيهِ الْرُوحِ. Allah blew into Adam from His spirit. The spirit, the ruh. What makes us really and truly human is not just the body, it is the ruh. And combined, that is how we form a living body. Now, the body needs nutrients. You need to take care of the body. What is the nutrients of the body? The body's nutrients will come from the same source as the body itself. Where did the body come from? The soil. Therefore, to feed the body, we turn to the soil. What comes from the soil? Fruits, vegetation, plants, animals that live on the soil, water that is stored in the soil. This is what feeds the body. Allah created the body from soil, so the nutrients of the body will be found in the soil. But you see, too many of us concentrate on the nutrients of the body, and they neglect to take care of the soul. They concentrate on feeding the body, but they forget that to be truly human, you're not just an animal. You're not just an animal that will take care of your physical body. That is what animals do. You are a human being who is far above the animals. Allah has blessed you with things He has not blessed the animals with. And of the greatest blessings is that of an intelligent soul. A soul that thinks and contemplates. So how do we nourish the soul? What food do we give to the soul? Well, where did the soul come from? What is the origin of the soul? وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْرُوحِ. They ask you about the soul. قُلِ الْرُوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. Say the soul is from the command of your Lord. The soul is from the command of my Lord. وَمَا أُوتِيتُ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. And of knowledge, you have been given nothing except a little. You don't know about the soul. You will never understand the soul. The soul is a mystery. The only thing we know, it comes from Allah. Directly from Allah. قُلِ الْرُوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. So the nutrients of the soul, how you will feed the ruh, is to reattach it to its source of origin. You reattach it to where it came from. You remind it of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every single deed that we do, every thought that we do, every statement that we say, that reminds us of Allah, that connects us with Allah, that establishes a link with Allah, this is how we nourish the soul. And so dhikr is the lifeline of the soul. And that is why when we don't feed the soul will die and wither away. And that is why our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, hadith Sahih Bukhari, مَثَلُ الَّذِي يَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ وَالَّذِي لَا يَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ كَمَثَلِ الْحَيِّ وَالْمَيِّتِ. The similitude, the example, the parable of the one who does dhikr compared to the one who does not do dhikr. What is the example and relationship? The similitude of the one who does dhikr compared to the one who does not do dhikr is like the living versus the dead. كَمَثَلِ الْحَيِّ وَالْمَيِّتِ. These are not my words. These are the words of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You do dhikr, you are alive. You don't do dhikr, you are dead. And this is a symbolic example that of course is profoundly true. Because when you don't feed the body, what's going to happen to the body? It will die. Well, no surprise, but when you don't feed the soul, what's going to happen to the soul? It will wither away and die as well. You can be a living human being, but your spirituality is dead. You can be a human being, and wallahi, every one of us knows such people. They have no spirituality at all. They eat, they drink, they walk, they talk as if they're living, but they have no hearts, they have no mercy, they have no spirituality. Why? Because they have neglected the soul. They haven't fed the soul. When we feed the soul, this is what gives us the spiritual life. And that is why Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, one of the greatest scholars in our ummah has seen, Ibn Taymiyyah said, the example of dhikr to the heart, listen to this, beautiful, the example of dhikr to the heart is like water is to a fish. The example of dhikr to the heart is like water is to a fish. So what do you think will happen, Ibn Taymiyyah asked, if you take the fish out of the water? What do you think will happen when the heart does not do dhikr? Of the blessings of dhikr, of the blessings of dhikr, is that dhikr brings about a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that would otherwise not exist. Dhikr opens up a door of communication, a door of conversation. This is how we converse with Allah. Even if Allah will not respond back in a way that we can hear. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the pinnacle of Iman is that you worship Allah as though you see Him. Because even if you don't see Him, He is seeing you. Similarly, dhikr is a conversation with Allah. It is as if Allah is speaking with you. Even though you don't hear Him, you are speaking to Him. Dhikr opens up that door of communication. Of the blessings of dhikr is that dhikr, Allah has promised us in the Quran that when we do dhikr, He will remember us. فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. You do my dhikr, I will do your dhikr. I want you to think about this simple blessing. You do my dhikr, I will do your dhikr. What more do we want from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than that He mentions us and remembers us? What does it mean we do dhikr of Allah? We know. We say subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah. But what does it mean Allah doing dhikr of us? What does it mean Allah doing dhikr of us? The scholars say Allah doing dhikr of us is that He cares for us and pays attention to us and answers our needs and du'as. When we remember Allah, Allah remembers us. When we remember Allah, Allah takes care of us. This is the meaning, فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Of the blessings of dhikr, is that dhikr brings about a sense of peace and serenity, a sense of joy and happiness that would otherwise never be present. Because you see, just like when you feed the body, how do you feel? You feel very comfortable. You feel very good body-wise. Similarly, when you feed the soul, your soul will feel elevated. Your soul will feel peaceful and serene. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبُ. Verily, only through the dhikr of Allah will the hearts find tranquility. Only through the dhikr of Allah will your hearts find tranquility. That's the only way. You will not find tranquility in any other way. If you don't find happiness in the dhikr of Allah, you're not going to find it anywhere else. Therefore, doing dhikr makes your hearts tranquil and peaceful. It removes you from the worries of this world. When you are connected with Allah through dhikr, when you are connected with Allah through dhikr, you cease to worry about the problems of this world. This world and all that it contains becomes insignificant for you. Not that the problems disappear, it's that they cease to be the biggest problems of your life. You have far bigger things to worry about, and that's the akhirah. And when you have Allah on your side, who cares what you don't have? When you have Allah, who cares what else you don't have? When you have everything that you need to, and that is your Lord, who cares what you have and not of this world? So by establishing dhikr, by frequently doing dhikr, you establish that direct connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that brings about the peace and serenity of the heart. Of the blessings of dhikr, is that dhikr guarantees us a beautiful death. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that whoever says La ilaha illallah as his last phrase will enter Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make up our last phrase on this one, La ilaha illallah. Now the question arises, how does one guarantee that one's last phrase will be La ilaha illallah? The scholars say, he who makes it a habit to say dhikr of Allah and say La ilaha illallah in his life, when he sees the angel of death, the first thing that will come to his tongue, to his mind, will to be to say the same dhikr that he was addicted to throughout his life. This is the habit of Allah. As you do throughout your life, so you shall be rewarded after your death. As you did throughout your life, that will be your love that you will say at the time of your death. Of the blessings of dhikr, is that dhikr is an act of worship that is easy to do and yet brings about many blessings. The Prophet ﷺ said, كَلِمَتَانِ خَفِيفَتَانِ عَلَى الْمِزَانِ حَبِيبَتَانِ إِلَى الرَّحْمَانِ ثَقِيلَتَانِ فِي الْمِزَانِ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَبِحَمْدِهِ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ الْعَظِيمِ. Two are the phrases very light on the tongue to say, very easy, and yet they are very heavy in the scales and very beloved to Allah. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah wa bihamdihi. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Subhanallah wa alhamdulillah tamla'u al-mizan. Saying Subhanallah and Alhamdulillah fills up the scales on the Day of Judgment. In another hadith, he said, La ilaha illallah is heavier than the entire creation. So easy to say, but the rewards are infinite. The rewards are more than we can count. And of the blessings of dhikr, you don't need to be in any state to do dhikr. You don't need to have wudu, you don't need to face the qibla, you can even do dhikr in the state of janaba or in the state of menses, it doesn't matter. Dhikr can be done in any state. Aisha reports, كَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ فِي كُلِّ أَحْيَانِ. The Prophet would do dhikr in all of his states. Doesn't matter what state you're in, you don't need to have wudu to do dhikr. Dhikr is an act of worship, you do it 24-7. You're waiting in line, you're stuck in traffic, you're waiting for your meeting, whatever it is, you can do dhikr right then and there. Without wudu, without facing the qibla, this is of the blessings of Allah, and the rewards are so great. Of the blessings of dhikr, is that dhikr will be the greatest factor that saves people from the fire of hell. In a hadith reported in Muslim Imam Ahmad, the Prophet said, nothing will save people more from the fire of hell than doing dhikr of Allah. Nothing will save people more from the fire of hell than doing dhikr of Allah. What does this mean? It means people who are destined to go to hell, people who deserve to go to hell, they will be saved by many factors. But the one factor that will save most of them, the number one factor that saves you from Jahannam after it has been decreed you are worthy of going there. Before I move on, think about that. What this means, we're talking about sinful Muslims. We're talking about people who are committing major sins. They deserve to go to hell. We're not talking about the elite of the elite. We're not talking about the creme de la creme. We're talking about average or below average Muslims. They have been decreed and destined that they deserve to go to hell. But still, Allah is merciful. And He will save them for various reasons. the number one factor, according to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that will save people from Jahannam after it has been decreed they go there, is the dhikr of Allah. How can Allah punish the tongue that continuously praises Him? How can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throw into Jahannam the body that is always doing dhikr, even if it has done other sins as well, even if it is guilty of other sins? There is an element of good as well, and that good will be manifested. SubhanAllah, brothers and sisters, an example that we all understand. A friend of yours, whom you always meet, and you always, he calls you up, he's always nice to you, he finds out how you're doing. If he is in need, and he says, "Akhi, I need a loan, can you give me a loan?" Would you rather give him a loan versus somebody who hardly mentions you, hardly thinks about you, hardly calls you, and then once in a year you might see him, then he calls you and he says, "Oh, Akhi, please, I need $1,000. Which of the two would you rather be merciful to? The one who always does your dhikr, or the one who doesn't ever do your dhikr? وَلِلَّهِ مَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى To Allah belongs the most perfect example. The sinner who does dhikr. The sinner who does dhikr is infinitely better than the sinner who does not do dhikr. And of course, the one who does not do a sin and does dhikr is even higher than them. Of the blessings of dhikr, is that dhikr beautifies your place in Jannah. Dhikr beautifies your place in Jannah. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he went on the journey of al-Isra wal-Mi'raj to the heavens, he met his father Ibrahim alayhi salam. And his father Ibrahim said to him, "O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nabbi ummataka minni salam. Give my salams to your ummah." The Prophet Ibrahim gave his salams to us through our own Prophet and his own son, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَأَخْبِرُهُمْ And I want you to tell them, this is Ibrahim speaking to us, the hadith is in Tirmidhi, it's authentic. وَأَخْبِرُهُمْ And inform them that Jannah is composed of fresh and luscious earth, but it is barren. Now hold on a second, this is shocking news. Jannah is barren. Jannah does not have fruits. How can you call a Jannah when it doesn't have trees? How can a Jannah be a Jannah when it's barren? The Prophet Ibrahim explained. And he said, and the seedlings of Jannah, seedlings, a small tree, you plant it, it must grow. It's not a seed, it's already sprouted. It's a guaranteed growth. The seedlings of Jannah, the khilas of Jannah, that every person will plant on his own plot, on his own crops. The seedlings of Jannah are SubhanAllah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Every time you say SubhanAllah, one more tree for you. Every time you say Alhamdulillah, one more Jannah to add to your Jannah. And no doubt, the more you say and the more trees you have, the larger plot you need. The more dhikr you do, the larger your share of Jannah. This is what our father Ibrahim alayhi salam is telling us. Brothers and sisters, the blessings of dhikr go on and on and on. But one hadith truly encapsulates all of this. It is narrated that an old man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he hobbled into the masjid. And he said, "Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, Islam has come to me when I am an old man. And I cannot do what your younger companions do. I cannot pray and fast to do what these guys are doing. I'm too old for that. So tell me of one thing that I can do by which I can reach that level. What should I do that will get me to that level?" So the Prophet ﷺ, in one version, he held on to his tongue and he said, "Alayka bi dhikrillah." I command you to do the dhikr of Allah because nothing is equivalent to it. In another version he said, "I command you to keep your tongue wet." What that means in Arabic, the English expression is, always have your tongue moving. Always have your tongue moving, doing the dhikr of Allah. When you have this level and status, when your tongue and your concept and your mind and your body and your soul, all it's doing is thinking of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what you have done is you have established beyond the shadow of a doubt. You have shown to yourself and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala how much you love Him, how much you care about Him, how much you appreciate and understand, how you need Him. Dhikr is the lifeline of it. heart. Dhikr is the pulse of the soul. Barakallahu wa lakum fi al-Qur'an al-Azim wa naf'ani wa iyyakum bima fihi min ayati wa dhikr al-hakim. Aqulu ma tasma'un wa astaghfirullaha al-'azim li wa lakum wa li sa'il muslimin li kulli dhanbin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwa al-ghafurur rahim.
Alhamdulillah. الحمد لله الواحد الأحد الفرد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد وبعد.
The question arises, how should one do dhikr? What is the methodology for doing dhikr? Again, much can be said, but time is of the essence, and I will summarize quickly by three very simple points. Three very simple points. First and foremost, true dhikr is that which is done through body and soul, through heart and mind and tongue, unified in one. Dhikr is not something that you repeat like a parrot. Dhikr is not something you open up a book and you have no idea what you're saying, and you just read through it. Dhikr is not something we do after the salah, like a speed train racing through subhanAllah, 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 subhanAllah. This is not dhikr. This is merely saying words with your tongue. Dhikr means you understand what you're saying. You appreciate the profundity of the statement, Subhanallah, how exalted is Allah, how glorified is Allah, how majestic is Allah, Alhamdulillah, may Allah be praised, may Allah be praised for my life, Alhamdulillah, may Allah be praised for my wealth, Alhamdulillah, may Allah be praised for my family. La ilaha illallah, there is nothing that I will worship other than Allah. No deity is worthy of my veneration, my love, my hope, my fear other than Allah. You say it, you understand it, and you mean it. This is what dhikr is. Not like racing through and seeing who can beat a world record to finish 33 times subhanAllah. You sit down and you do your dhikr the way it should be done. Body and soul, heart and mind combined in one. Number two, the best dhikr to do is the adhkar of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are many books people write, many wills and wazifas that they invent. But who can write a better will? Who can demonstrate a better wazifa? Who can tell you a better methodology than our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Why don't we find out what dhikrs he used to do? What did he used to say after the salah? What did he used to say when he entered the house, when he exited the house, when he entered the masjid, when he left the masjid? What did he used to say when he saw something good, when he saw something frightful? What were the adhkar of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So what were the adhkar and what was his habit and methodology? There can be no dhikr better than his dhikr. And that's why Allah sent the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to us, so that he'd be a role model. There are many, many books written about the dhikrs of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But of the easiest one is one written in the modern times by Dr. Bahbani, and it's called Fortification of the Muslim Through Prayer and Remembrance. A small pocket-sized booklet, you'll find it sold everywhere, and really this is a gem. It's a beautiful book. You can put it in your pocket, open it up, and see what adhkar the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would do at any particular time. The third point that I want to remind us of. First, I said dhikr should be done body and soul, heart and mind. Second, memorize the adhkar of the Prophet ﷺ and use them. The third point of dhikr, realize that dhikr is a blessing from Allah. And like all blessings, Allah decides who gets it. Therefore, like every blessing, we must ask Allah to give us this blessing. So we have to make dua to Allah to perfect our dhikr. In one hadith of Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Mu'adh ibn Jabal, and Mu'adh ibn Jabal is a very famous and special Sahabi. He told Mu'adh ibn Jabal, "Oh Mu'adh, wallahi inni la uhibbuk. I love you for the sake of Allah, oh Mu'adh." And few are the people whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this to. And Mu'adh is one of them. Therefore, he is telling Mu'adh, therefore, never forget to say after every single salah, every time you finish a fard prayer, never forget to say this dua, Allahumma a'inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatika. Oh Allah, help me, aid me, make it easy for me to do your dhikr. Make it easy for me to remember you and to worship you properly and to thank. If you really want to do dhikr properly, ask Allah to bless you with that. Otherwise, you are not going to get it. Brothers and sisters, the concept of dhikr is the life of the heart. It is the pulse of the soul. Dhikr is what demonstrates for us our iman and taqwa. And the opposite is also true. If we don't have dhikr, it shows that we lack that iman and taqwa. Allah says in the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe. لا تلهكم أموالكم ولا أولادكم عن ذكر الله. Make sure that your families and your monies and your children, make sure this world does not prevent you from doing one thing, ذكرullah. That's the whole point of life. That's why Allah created me and you, to remember and worship Him. Make sure your families and your children and your money don't prevent you from doing dhikr of Allah. وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَٰلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. Whoever does so, he is the real loser. خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةَ. He's lost this world, he's lost the next, and that is the greatest loss. اللهم إني داعٍ فأمنوا. اللهم لا تدع لنا في هذا اليوم ذنبًا إلا غفرته، ولا همًا إلا فرجته، ولا دينًا إلا قضيته، ولا مريضًا إلا شفيته، ولا عسيرًا إلا يسرته. اللهم اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان، ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلًا للذين آمنوا، ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم من أرادنا وأراد الإسلام والمسلمين بسوء فاجعله بنفسه، واجعل تدبيره في تدبيره يا قوي يا عزيز. عباد الله، إن الله تعالى أمركم بأمر بدأ به بنفسه، وثنى بملائكة قدسه، وثلث بكم أيها المؤمنون من جنه وإنسه، فقال عز من قائل عليما، إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك رسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. عباد الله، إن الله تعالى يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم، واشكروه يزد لكم، ولذكر الله تعالى أعلى وأجل وأكبر. والله تعالى أعلم. وأقم الصلاة.
يا زمانا له أشكو غربتي، إن كانت الشكوى تدر